on a Saturday in our living room, we watched it begin again. And that is this YouTube video.
Hi guys, welcome to whatever this is.
We, as of this moment, have a joint musical YouTube channel
where we are gonna talk and share our opinions. We're gonna discuss our favorite music with you guys. We're going to react to new music with you guys. And yeah, if you don't know, my name's Bonny.
I'm Emily.
And we probably talk about music at least 50% of our conversation.
Like, I'd say it's...
because we talk about a lot of things. But we love talking about it so much, so we thought we would just sit down and start recording it because, you know, maybe someone will want to listen to that.
And it would just be so nice to know that there are other people who feel the same way that we do about the music taste that we have.
Yes, totally. We want to have a little community on here.
Like friends. Where, like friends who get it.
Yeah, exactly. We thought that our first video will be a Taylor Swift related video just because she is definitely the first person that we really, really bonded over in terms of music.
We're... overwhelming Taylor Swift fans, and we're starting off with a discussion about Taylor Swift's most recent album, Lover, which came out in August 2019. And
this was extremely hard for us to decide if we wanted to start at the beginning of her
timeline, story,
albums. Or if we wanted to work backwards.
But we're going with Lover because it's the most recent, it's currently the most discussed. I'm personally ready to spill the tea.
I don't even know if there are YouTube channels like this out there. Obviously, we want to do a lot of reaction videos, but this one is going to be playing the songs, talking about our favorite lyrics, talking about what they mean, telling you the story. So if you are not a Taylor Swift fan, welcome. Get ready for your education. And if you are a Taylor Swift fan, let's talk about it. Let's discuss why we love her album so much.
There's just so many reasons.
I'm overwhelmed.
So the first song is I Forgot That You Existed, and there's much to say. There's already much to say.
How many days did I spend thinking about how you did me wrong, wrong, wrong? And I couldn't get away from you. In my feelings more than drinks, so but then something happened one magical night.
So already I feel like we can see that this album is taking a much different direction to her last one. It's a lot lighter, it's a lot bubblier. Reputation was her album just before this, and it was much darker. It kind of covered all of the drama that she went through with Kim and Kanye, and just like the breakup, and maybe like we'll give you a little brief history on her romantic life.
Around like 2015, 2016, she was in a very high profile relationship with Calvin Harris. And I think that like she was really at the peak of her career after 1989, which was the album that she released in late 2014. And so she was just, you know, obviously in this very high profile relationship that all came crashing down. And she almost immediately then was spotted everywhere with Tom Hiddleston, who she dated for a few months.
She went straight to Tom Hiddleston and then she just disappeared because the media got so intense, kind of shaming her for moving on really quickly, you know, saying things about Calvin Harris and their breakup. Calvin Harris came out and started tweeting about her, and then she just disappeared for like a year, and then we got Reputation. And during Reputation, you figure out, during Reputation and Lover, you figure out that that's when she met Joe. Joe Alwyn, who's an actor. This is who she's with now, and that's who Lover is about. And we kind of just delve into that relationship in the last two albums.
I forgot that you existed. And I thought that it would kill me, but it didn't. It isn't love, it isn't hate, it's just indifference.
We feel that this song is about Calvin Harris.
Yeah.
Some argue that it could be about her feud with Kanye West.
Yeah.
But even in a more broader sense, I feel like it's almost acknowledging the past that was that darker era of her doing Reputation. And it's almost just like, I'm moving into this like happier, lighter phase of my life.
And I would've stuck around for you.
It's very difficult to tell if it's about Kanye or Calvin as well, because they're both musicians.
Even the beginning lyric of that verse, I forgot that you got out some popcorn as soon as my rep started going down. So she obviously, she references rep.
Yeah.
But yes, I feel like, I mean, Calvin Harris came out on Twitter and really berated her.
He just pushed her down even more once Kanye was already blowing everything up.
I forgot that you sent me a clear message. They were. It's all just a blur.
say. Okay. So the first thing that makes me feel like this song is about Calvin and not Kanye is that I can't remember if it was on when she said it in like a behind the scenes video or if it was in the journals that came out with the album. She'd mm-hmm. written down original lyrics mm-hmm. and the original lyric before she changed it was "I thought that I would miss you, but I didn't."
Oh.
Instead of "I thought that it would kill
me." That's not Kanye.
So that was a clear indicator that when she was writing this song, she had Calvin in her heart, in her mind, because she wouldn't miss Kanye, you know what I mean? Like, she wouldn't miss someone that wasn't her boyfriend. But also the line, "You taught me some hard lessons, but I just forget what they were. It's all just a blur." I feel like she doesn't forget what Kanye taught her. I don't know. For some reason, I feel like that was just such a big period in her life.
Yeah.
That she doesn't forget that. With Calvin, she never even fucking acknowledged him. She literally never acknowledged him in an album, in a song. Like, I just feel like she literally forgot he existed.
I agree. I don't think that she's anytime soon going to forget the lessons that she learned from that feud. But I do think that you can forget a shitty relationship. Just like,
and it does feel like you, a bit of a blur when you're breaking up and all of that kind of stuff. Let me know. We would love to know what you guys' thoughts are on this, because I feel like it's definitely... it could go either way. We're going to go straight on to Cruel Summer because I think we've covered I Forgot You Existed. And just a heads up, this is probably our second favourite song on the album collectively, would you say?
I'm going to rank Cruel Summer at number 3. I hesitate to say that.
I'm confused. What could possibly be above Cruel Summer?
Whoa,
what are you gonna fuck me up with?
I mean, on my top 20, London Boy is higher than Cruel
Summer. Oh, no, I think you're going through a phase of London Boy.
No, I'm not. No, it was there before the London Boy phase. Oh. Collectively, as a fandom, everyone knows that Cruel Summer is one of the most superior songs she's ever written.
Yeah.
But definitely on this album, it's one of those songs that I think, we've learned, it can take a little bit to kind of understand it.
Oh, definitely. So far, we've gotten a lot of lyrics that may seem quite negative in this song.
I'm sorry, the opening lyric, "Fever dream high in the quiet of the night, you know that I caught it." Like, this person is a disease and there are consequences.
Yeah, yeah. "Devils roll the dice, angels roll their eyes."
Oh, such a superior lyric.
Like, "devils roll the dice," as in, like, I'm gambling on this.
Odds are against me.
Yeah. "Angels roll their eyes," because they're like, "Oh, here we go again,
you're doing it again."
Oh, it's such a good lyric. It literally encapsulates so much detail in so few words.
And that's just something that Taylor regularly does, as you will come to understand.
So far we're kind of feeling like her frustration in the song. We don't know if it's good, we don't know if it's bad.
The other part of the chorus, "It's cool, that's what I tell him, no rules, unbreakable heaven."
I just love that lyric, "it's cool, that's what I tell him," because that's instantly giving you the picture that she's playing it cool, she's pretending it's cool, but it's absolutely not cool. And saying "unbreakable heaven" is meaning this is paradise, but it's fragile.
I have my first thing to say just about the composition. Something that I picked up really early on is she has these backing vocals in the chorus. I mean, the actual melody is, "it's cool, that's what I tell them, no rules, unbreakable heaven." But so then the backing vocals, she says, "it's cool, that's what I tell them, no rules."
Yeah, she goes down. The thing about Taylor Swift, her backing vocals are perfection. And they always build towards the end of the song. "I'm drunk in the back of the car and I cry like a baby coming home from the bar. Oh, I'm fine, but it wasn't true. I don't want to keep secrets just to keep you and I scream for whatever it's worth. I love you, ain't that the worst thing you ever heard? Hey, let's all get it like a girl. It's you, she's so good." Like, we all know Taylor Swift. Well, if you don't know, Taylor Swift is a genius at writing bridges. She has just so many good ones. "I snuck in through the garden gate every night that summer just to seal my fate. And I scream for whatever it's worth, I love you, ain't that the worst thing you ever heard? What we would like to know is your opinion on this, if you are a Taylor Swift fan, is when we first heard this song, we both kind of mutually agreed that it's not about Joe and that it's probably about a past relationship where she had some struggles, or maybe it's about Tom Hiddleston even. We weren't really sure of who to pinpoint it to, but recently we've been thinking that it is more about Joe and it actually was about the beginning stages of their relationship, because it would have been really, really chaotic. She would have just been coming out of everything with Tom Hiddleston.
There's these high profile relationships and she doesn't want to do that anymore, and she knows the consequences of being that open with a relationship that's probably going to fail. And so you've got these thoughts in the back of your mind, probably like, I don't know if this is it. This could just end at any time. And she has explained as well that Love of the Album is about like all different facets of love, and so like including this kind of a song on the album, it obviously is a more negative energy, and describes a very difficult stage in love, but it's a stage nonetheless, especially for someone like her.
Let me know if you guys disagree, if you think it's about a past relationship. Yes. All right, should we continue on to the next song?
I think we should continue on to the next song. I do just want to end that by saying that she repeats the bridge because she knows it's superior.
Oh, absolutely. And yeah, we go into the bridge again and that's what it ends with. And I love a bridge repeat. Okay, the next track is called Lover, which is the title track of the album and has been like probably one of the biggest singles off the album. So... production. We need to talk about Jack Antonoff because we haven't said that yet.
Oh my god.
If you don't know,
oh my god,
this album is produced by Jack Antonoff.
I can't believe you'd even say his name.
This album is produced by Jack Antonoff. He has worked with her on her last three albums.
Superior Human.
And he also co-wrote a lot of the songs with her as well. And for a lot of the part, you know, Taylor Swift, if you don't know, one of the reasons why we love Taylor Swift so much is that she writes her own music. So everything you're hearing is coming from her. Obviously, she has co-writers, but not like most pop stars. Like
this song is actually self-written.
Yeah, this song is self-written. Like, yeah. And three of the songs on this album are completely self-written. She's had a whole album self-written before. And when she does have writers, they very much just kind of input small things, and she is always the main songwriter on all of her songs. So that alone is just something that needs to be respected a lot more, because most pop stars these days don't write their own music, and even if they
are like they do, but have like 10 co-writers.
Yes, exactly.
Really, how much of it did you write?
Yeah. So we just love Jack Antonoff. He's produced other albums for Lana Del Rey and Lorde. He's just absolutely phenomenal. But the sound that he's given this song is so nostalgic, comforting. Like this song is hugging me.
It's funny because Taylor Swift is known for writing about love. That's what she does. But this is the first time she's ever written
a love song
actually like comfortable, secure, and in love in a relationship.
Oh, even when this song first came out, people were like, are they married? Like, we literally maybe thought...
I thought that she was going to release a music video and it's going to be footage of their fucking wedding.
Same. Oh, God, I wanted that so bad.
I wanted that so bad.
Oh, my God. Can you imagine if we got that? I would be dead. I wouldn't be living.
I wouldn't have survived that. What the hell?
The lyrics are really simple, but that is the point. Like, we could let our friends crash in the living room if we wanted to, because that it's summing up that we have this home together now, and like we get to make those choices together as a couple. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please stand? With every guitar string scar on my head, I take this magnetic force of a man to be my lover.
One of the first songs that we feel is written about Joe and is on Reputation is Gorgeous. Mm-hmm. And she says in Gorgeous, you should think about the consequence of your magnetic field being a little too strong.
Yes.
And in this song, she says, I take this magnetic force of a man to be my lover. And it's just...
She always does that.
I love how she ties in lyrics and she does it a lot in this album.
Oh, yeah.
Where she ties it in with past lyrics.
Past
that
albums,
she's done, so
past lyrics, yeah.
She's telling the audience, like, this is the same story,
yes, yeah,
or, you know, a different, like,
a different aspect of that story.
Or...
But obviously, also, these lyrics are very much so vows. Ladies and
yes,
gentlemen, will you please stand? This is definitely my favorite lyric in the bridge, is with every guitar string scar on my hand, mm, I take this magnetic force of a man.
Like, I have written so many songs about fucked up boys I've
yeah,
dated in the past who have all hurt me and I'm scarred on my hands, but I want you to take them and be my fucking lover.
Totally. So the next song is track number 4 and it's titled The Man.
Yes.
I would be complex, I would be cool. They'd say I played the field before I found someone to commit to. I'd be a fearless leader, I'd be an alpha type. When everyone believes ya, what's that like?
I need to stop it right there. The thing with this song is that, like, I don't know how anyone is able to so perfectly put into words literally what it's like to be a woman.
Yes, yeah. And to be a woman in her position.
A woman in her position, but it's also so relatable just on, like, a general, like, equality level of, like they'd say I played the field before I found someone to commit to.
And that would be okay.
You don't have to say that about a girl!
No.
Like, oh, yeah, she's a slut.
She's a slut, yeah. That's what
Or she's
said.
Fucked around.
Yeah.
Or I'm not into her because she's had too much sex.
Yeah.
Or whatever it is. Like,
but wording, they played the field before they found someone to commit
to. Yeah, you know, they had to see what was out there before they decided
they
that
right
she was the one.
That. Yeah. Exactly.
But for us, it's like...
But for us, we're shamed for it. Yeah.
On the Lisa, what's that like? I'm so sick of running as fast as I can.
Oh.
Wondering if I get there.
So perfectly.
Because she's not hating on guys directly.
No.
She's literally just saying, I'm running as fast as I can, and I know if I was a guy, I'd be there quicker. And it's genius.
What I was wearing, if I was rude, could I be separated from my good ideas and power moves?
That line is so much truth. Like, how many times have you heard someone say, oh, he's a dickhead, but he's a genius businessman, or he's a this, but he's got great ideas? Like, people separate men's personal, like, how they are as a person to their accomplishments all the time.
Oh.
The girls,
people
it's not
hate
like that.
On, like, female leaders because she seems like a
bitch. Oh, she's yeah. It's lumped into one. Her dating life is lumped into how successful she is as a musician.
Yeah.
Which shouldn't have anything to do with it because she's so freaking talented.
What's it like to brag about $15 and getting bitches and models? And it's so good if you're bad, and it's okay if you're mad.
I had no idea what to expect when I first heard this song. I didn't know what the man meant.
No.
But well, after hearing it, I was just mind blown by how much of a bad bitch she is to make this song.
It's funny because, like, she couldn't have been more of a bad bitch
after
that, after Reputation, and then she went and did that. Like, okay, we get it.
And moving on to The Archer, which is track 5. Now, if you are a dedicated Swiftie, you will already know that track 5 is the vulnerable track on the album. Every single album, she always hits us hard with track 5.
Yeah.
It's usually the track that makes us cry or makes us feel things or makes us see something in a completely different light,
yeah,
and that's exactly what she does with The Archer,
yeah,
so let's dive into
that. I would just like to preface this with saying that The Archer is actually not... neither one of us consider this a favourite.
Yes, yes.
But it's a very respectable favourite for others if it is your favourite. Like, it's a very well-written song.
Yeah.
Self self-reflective. It's very self-aware.
Easy they come, easy they go. I jump from the train. I ride off alone. I never grew up. It's getting so old. Help me hold on to you. So that's even getting frustrated with herself in that moment. And easy they come, easy they go. I've had a lot of relationships pass by. What if no one stays? What if I never grow up? It's this really vulnerable moment of being like,
people are sick of me.
People are sick of me.
Yeah.
I'm sick of my own shit. People are sick of my own shit.
Yeah.
Why would anyone stay?
I've been the archer, I've been the prey. I think it could, it very much so relates to her career and her personal relationships.
I think so,
you know,
too.
I've been the prey. I've been extremely hurt by people. I've been targeted by men in the past.
Yes.
You know,
and that's
people have taken me for granted.
This song can be taken so much as her entire life, not just love or romance.
Yeah.
Because I think she's saying in general, people have messed me over and I messed other people over, and who could stay in my life in general. Even just saying who could ever leave me, darling. I think she's being quite honest with the fact that, you know, she's obviously Taylor Swift, but at the same time, she's like, but who could stay?
Because
like,
this I am just Taylor so Swift. Much like, to deal with. Who, who could deal with everything that comes with being with Taylor Swift?
And still so relatable at the same time.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like that line is still, everyone feels that to some degree, like who could stay? Who could put up with me? Like, I've got all these things wrong with me. Like,
I've got so many great things,
I have,
so many great qualities,
yes.
but also so many bad ones that it's just like,
and
who the fuck's going to hang around? First lyric that makes, like, convinces me that she's specifically talking about her relationship with Joe in this song rather than her life as a whole. That
dark,
you know,
side.
I search for your dark side, like I'm trying to find a fault in you, but I'm actually perfect here with you. And I cut off my nose just to spite my face, and I hate my reflection for years and years. Like, self-sabotaging, like,
because there's so many fucking good lyrics in this song.
I know, there's so
and
many.
All of my heroes die all alone. Help me hold on to you.
Like, everyone that,
she that
I idolize, they don't end up happy.
No.
So why the fuck am I going to be happy?
Exactly. Also, can we just talk about Jack Antonoff again for a second? The
absolutely.
Production on this song is so unique, and so the way, at first, I was like, I really wish it built and exploded, but now I see the value in it staying exactly the same pace the whole way through, because it's like this anxiety behind the song as well.
Oh,
and
it's like totally
it's
anxiety-inducing.
Yeah.
And I'd just like to summarize the fact that she keeps repeating the lyric throughout the song, help me hold on to you. Like, she's literally acknowledging, like, I know I'm just in my head right now. Help me get to a place where I can just accept that this relationship is everything I've ever wanted, and be comfortable with that without thinking about everything that could come and fuck this up.
Oh. So then at the end, she's just going, who could stay, who could stay, who could stay, you could stay, you could stay. And I think that's that's definitely to Joe, but I also think that's a little to the fans.
Well, actually, you could stay. Like, it's like she's coming out of her head a little bit.
She's
maybe.
Like, you could stay. Like, maybe, there's hope.
There's hope. Yeah.
Next track is number 6, and it's I Think He Knows.
Yes.
His hands around a cold glass make me wanna know that body like it's mine. No one understands. He got my heart beating, skipping down 16th Avenue, got that I gotta tell him I think he knows. I think he knows.
It's just nothing that we really need to analyze in this song.
No.
It's a very self-explanatory song.
Yeah.
So different though to anything that she's done before.
Oh, so different the sound. It's an absolute bop, first of all.
Absolute bop.
The beat of it is just like, I want to absolutely dance my heart out to this song. Like, and just an instant mood lift to that chorus.
Yeah.
Like, how can it make you so happy?
Yeah. Even the lyric, I think he knows his hands around a cold glass make me want to know that body like it's mine. She references in a lot of songs in this album, but also in Reputation, about her and Joe meeting in kind of like a bar sort of setting.
Yeah, exactly. You're right. Like the early stages of the relationship hint at a bar many times. And it feels like this was written around the same time as something like Maybe Delicate or something. But it's
totally.
Like a completely different emotion in the relationship
totally.
At that moment.
Yeah, totally.
Is the fact that she builds those backing vocals into it. The second chorus, she adds that heartbeat, skipping that, like she adds that in.
Yeah.
And obviously that I mean, and like she adds that in the third chorus as well. And I love those little details. That's like one of my favorite things about Taylor Swift songs. Like, I love that her vocals are good and amazing, but she's never really super show-offy with her vocals. And she just adds in the perfect
little
thing at the right time that makes you just go, oh. The next song is number 7, Miss Americana and the Heartbreak Prince.
Yeah.
It's been a long time coming, but you and me, that's my whole world. They whisper in the hallway, she's a bad, bad girl. The whole school is rolling fake dice. You play stupid games, you win stupid prizes.
So I feel like this song was probably one of the harder songs to break down the meaning of, but also like one that got a lot of attention because it's got such a deep metaphor behind it.
The main thing is she's obviously making a lot of reference to like a school sort of setting and like, you know, I guess like a high school relationship sort of thing. But the underlying sort of metaphor is really just the political state of America right now.
Yeah. So what I take is the whole first bit is kind of like almost a bit of a love letter to the country, America, and kind of talking about her relationship with it and how she's always loved this country, but, you know, she's scared of the current political state. But she's wrapped it into a high school love metaphor.
Yeah.
So that it's also relatable to, like, maybe younger people, but also just, it's really clever. That bit there is, like, my favorite part of the whole song because it's just so perfectly worded. American stories burning before me. I'm feeling helpless. The damsels are depressed. So talking about girls there and like just, you know, the president of America and how, you know, how that is. I don't want you to go. I don't really wanna fight. Cause nobody's gonna win. You should come. And I'll never let you. Cause I know this is a fight. That someday we're gonna win.
Yeah, that's so good as well. How she changes it at the end to like evoke hope.
Yes, evoke hope. And that could be about a relationship, that could be about a school, like, you know, a school relationship, but it's so, so good how she tied it in with the metaphor of it being about politics and like, and a love
and
letter to
like
her country.
It sounds like a cheer, like a
it
cheerleading
does.
Cheer. It's like, just the way it's sung is like wrapping up into that high school metaphor.
Yeah, is definitely not one of my favorite tracks on the album, and we will give you our top 5 or top 4 in order at the end of the album.
Yeah.
But I can appreciate it for just the mastery that it is with the lyrics.
It's a very well written song.
Yeah. Next up is
Paper Rings.
Paper Rings, track number 8.
Yes. This is another one of those songs that I feel like doesn't require a lot of explanation. It just is just a very happy song.
The moon is high like your friends were the night that we first met. Went home and tried to stalk you on the internet. Now I've read all the books beside your bed.
This song is so high energy and I love how fast the lyrics are. Immediately I love a challenge with lyrics like that. Like, I love learning really fast, detailed lyrics. For those of you who don't know, she met Joe at the Met Gala, which is also the same night that she met Tom Hiddleston. That is a detail that you'll grow to learn more about as we delve into the albums.
Yes.
But it is a nice little like detail that she's added in there by saying met.
I think it's also just so interesting how like this isn't the only time in her songs that she references being totally captivated by him the night that they met.
He's gorgeous
but,
as well.
Like, also, he's not the guy that she ended up with immediately after. Like, she actually ended up with another guy that she met that night.
Which is what's so fascinating.
Went home and tried to stalk him on the internet.
The wine is cold, like the shoulder that I gave you in the street. Cat and mouse for a month or two or three. Now I wake up in the night and watch you breathe.
That really gives me so much detail because it ties back into things like Cruel Summer and stuff because she's like, it wasn't on from the moment. There was struggles. Cat and mouse for a month or two or three. Like, 3 months is summer. It's a cruel summer. I think it's obviously so cute that she's saying I'd marry you with paper rings. Like, just a really good metaphor for like how much she's in love with this guy. And just for reference, the 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4 is Jack Antonoff, the guy that produces these songs, which is really fun.
I want to drive away with you. I want your complications too. I want your dreary Mondays. Wrap your arms around me, baby boy.
I want your shitty Mondays.
Yes, yeah.
And all the crap that comes with being with you.
Yes.
Because that's how much I love you.
Next song is Cornelia Street, track 9.
What the fuck?
We were in the backseat, drunk on something stronger than the drinks in the bar. And I hope I never lose you, hope it never ends. I never walk Cornelia Street again. And baby, I can be set by how this city screams your name.
So I guess like the summary of this song is that she rented a place on Cornelia Street in New York when she first met Joe, and this whole song is reflecting on the memories that they built in that house together and how if they ever broke up, she could never fucking walk down that street again.
And I think it's really interesting because I remember when we first listened to the album, you were a little bit hesitant about the song because you were like, well, that's just like a very specific thing.
Totally, yeah.
Like,
yeah.
You know, like, not people can't relate to
it. Yeah.
But I think it's just really important because it's just like, everyone has that like place or song or smell or something that's
that
just like you could just never touch that again.
Yes. Yeah.
Because like maybe it already does remind you of someone else that you're not with anymore.
Card sharks playing games, I thought you were leading me on. There's so many little references, even in these happy songs, that take you back to the beginning of the relationship maybe being rocky. And that's why she can get away with making songs like Cruel Summer and maybe Dancing With Our Hands Tied and stuff, because there was so much diversity in how their relationship started. And she really does explore all elements of that.
But then you called, showed your hand, I turned around before I hit the tunnel sack. On the roof, you and I.
And this kind of song is very different because, I mean, obviously the fact that it's obviously written from a perspective of like a lot of, I guess quite a lot of security in the relationship, but also acknowledging that past and everything as well.
Yeah.
It's not a perspective she's ever written from before.
No, it's not. It really is it's so fresh.
Yeah.
This song is so fresh, but still has elements of her old songwriting, like All Too Well and things, which makes it so nostalgic and so Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
Like it's...
And I personally really love how she says sat on the roof, you and I, because I that just reminds me of a lyric in King of My Heart, which is a song on Reputation, because she says up on the roof with a schoolgirl crush. Like, it's just very interesting how many it's funny, you know, actually, because all of her songs, like, they evoke a different kind of feeling about the relationship, and you don't actually, like, so much so
that you
don't actually necessarily make the connection that in so many songs she's referencing the bar, sneaking around, people don't know about us, we're up on the roof, like, we're getting drunk all the time, like, seeing each other, like, she says it
in so many different
countless
ways.
Times that you don't even necessarily pick up on the connection because there's other aspects of each of those songs that
you're like, oh my god, that could have been the same night, that could have been the same time. Well, this could have been that. Like, it all falls together once you, the more you analyze it, which is why it's so fulfilling to analyze her albums.
How this city screams your name.
next up is
Death by a Thousand Cuts. So this is absolutely number one on the album. Yeah, if you're sleeping on it,
stop.
Actual superior song.
Yeah.
Straight to top five Taylor Swift songs of all time.
Yeah.
Songs with an upbeat melody.
Yeah.
Perfectly produced by Daddy fucking Jack Antonoff.
This song we know for sure is not about her relationship with Joe because she's come out and she's spoken about it. It was inspired by a movie called Someone Great on Netflix. You should watch it. It's really, really,
it's
really, really good.
And it makes sense.
And it makes total sense once you watch the movie. But yeah, she pretty much watched it and just this idea just came to her just because she is God and she is talented like that. So she wrote this superior song. And she said even it means a lot to her because she thought maybe she could not write breakup songs anymore because she's so happy in a relationship. But this is just a perfect, perfect breakup song, summing up pretty much just how deathly ill you feel when you break up with someone that you've been with for a long time or just that was so difficult to break up with. And it really just is putting that into words. Through the windows of this love. Oh my God. Every single time I listen to it. How many times have we listened to this song? That's what I don't understand.
It doesn't get old.
I think it gets better.
Everything. My heart, my hips, my body, my love, my time, my why, my spirit, my trust. Fuck you.
Literally. But I can't speak. The reason why this bridge is just so beyond offensive is the emotion behind it. And you know what? You think it's going to end and then it doesn't. She comes at you with the my time, my wine. Like, she keeps going, and that's why it's so good, because the emotion that you're feeling when you relate to this is a rant. Yeah.
It's a Jack Rantanoff. It's a Jack Rantanoff.
You just know the moment they wrote that this bridge together, they had an absolute connection.
They need to, like, they better have fucking filmed it.
They better have filmed it, because it'll be like the Getaway Car moment.
Yeah.
Like, just that, the feeding off each other. I just want to see that. I just want to see it so much.
Same. Put the wind here, because I can't.
It's okay when it's not. No, it's not. It's death by a thousand cuts.
Honestly, I don't know.
I don't know what else to say because it's just...
There's nothing else to say.
Sorry. Look.
This next song is my number two.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
it doesn't require much explanation except it's the biggest fucking bop you'll ever hear in your life.
Yes. Here we go with...
London Boy.
I love my hometown.
To break breakdown in this song. She's pretty much just a love letter to her London boy, Joe. And yeah. She's just saying all the things that she loves. At the beginning, she's like, I love everything, like these things about America.
I love my home, but like your superior, like, and London's great.
Love being with you.
And that's it.
Every chorus has a different beginning bit. I love how she changes that each time. Just adds so much more detail to the story.
Yes. Absolutely number one perfectly produced song on the album. Like the nothing, like the noises, the melody, every inch of sound in this song is perfect for the vibe. When I be with you. I mean, the whole song is a feel good. You can't feel happy when you're not listening to that song.
Oh, impossible.
You know, I'm gonna say, let's skip Soon You'll Get Better. You just don't need to know anything except that it is a beautifully written song.
Yeah.
Very depressing about her mum being
like crying
ill
right now, but yeah.
Yeah. Listen to that in your own time.
To sum it up, her mum has cancer and she's been fighting that battle for quite a few years. As you can imagine, it's a very, very upsetting song. It's about Soon You'll Get Better. Like her hoping pretty much that she'll get better. Next track on the album is False God. This song has a really different feel from the rest of the album. I love how it starts with the saxophone. It absolutely sets the mood, sets the vibe. It's a much more sensual song.
It's the first song on the album that we thought like maybe could have fit on Reputation in terms of the vibe if she wanted it to. Religion's in your lips, even if it's a false god. Like, even if we fight, even if we fuck up, like we're kind of dedicated to this.
Yes.
We worship this.
Yeah.
I know heaven's a thing.
This song, I really wish there was a bridge. Like, I feel like
there's
it ends
no bridge,
a little bit too quickly. And
it's a very short song. It's only 2 minutes something.
Yeah, so I would have really liked a bridge in there. But overall, I think it's a good song. And I think it's a really good, perfect kind of break in in the other sounds that we've had. Something different and just showing her talent once again.
So the next song is You Need to Calm Down. I don't know if we feel like we want to react to that. It's a song that everyone, I think, knows quite well. Obviously, just another example on the album of her being, I guess, a little bit more political and outspoken. So definitely something relatively new for her. It's a great song. It's a bop. I think the next one we need to do is Afterglow.
Oh my God, such a good song!
Such a good song. This is also another one that we, like, loved the second that we heard it.
Yeah.
Superior metaphor, which we will explain.
Oh, yes. Superior metaphor. Oh, yeah.
I blew things out of proportion. Now you blew. I need to say, hey, it's only in my head. Hey, hey, it's only. Just don't go. Maybe in the afterglow.
First of all, production. Perfect.
Nothing to say.
Perfect. Nothing to say. But also, I love this song so much because it's really the first time that we're getting Taylor to completely take all the blame on this album anyway for maybe a fight that they've had or a blow-up that they had. And she's being really vulnerable in that sense of, you know, saying, I put
it's
you
all
in
me
jail.
In my head.
Yeah, I put you in jail for something you didn't do. I pinned your hands behind your back. I thought I had reason to attack. Like, she's saying all these things where, like, it's in my head. The metaphor that I... like thought it was and that we've discussed since it popped into my head was that the afterglow is just like after they've burnt down, so like after they've had a fight and you know, it's all blown up in their
faces. Well, she says, I'm the one who burned us down.
So it's like, and it's insinuating that there's a fire and that there's been a big blowout, and then she's like, hey, meet me in the afterglow. So the afterglow, once the ashes are kind of just like glowing, and that's what it's just a clever metaphor.
It's very clever. And I mean, the rest of the song is really sort of much the same, like just taking the blame for, you know, causing this argument that probably didn't need to
happen.
Yeah. Tell me that you're still mine. Tell me that we'll be just fine. Even when I lose my mind, I need to say, hey. This is a favorite for me. Like, yeah, this me is too. One that really stood out as soon as I listened to it. I just can't believe how good it sounds.
Yeah. Next one is another song that I think that maybe we can skip over reacting to. Yeah. It's Me. It was the first song released from the album.
So much love attached to that beginning of that song because it's, it's the first glimpse that you get into this upbeat, different album. And like,
it's a whole new sound.
It's definitely not my favorite. Yeah, definitely not my favorite song on the album at all for many reasons. But I just love the energy that that song brings, and I don't know. I just think it's a bop.
Yeah.
Next one we're gonna listen to is "It's Nice to Have a Friend," and this song on the album was one that we were really a little bit confused about
in terms of what she's singing about. I don't feel overly confused anymore, but Taylor Swift doesn't have a song that's not superior.
No.
Like, every Taylor Swift song is superior, but like, this personally for me is down the bottom, and I haven't in the last 10 months or whatever it's been since Love has been out seen many people talk about it. Like, it just doesn't seem to be a crowd favorite.
No, I think that I think it's very unique in the way that it's written, and as we listen to it, you guys might pick up on that. It's just it's very vague, and the way it's written is, I can't even explain it. Like, let me know what your thoughts are about "It's Nice to Have a Friend" down below. In the whole song, and I also really like how she says "light pink sky up on the roof," because that is probably the third or fourth time that she references the roof.
Yeah,
and that makes you think of maybe Cornelia Street as well.
We tell the truth, like, we're getting to know each other.
Yeah.
It's actually another sort of school metaphor, the whole thing, but each verse is a different stage in their relationship.
Yes.
Like, the beginning one is like, we're kind of kids, you want to hang out, yeah, it sounds like fun. Like,
and then the third one even could insinuate that they're getting married or something, because she says rice on the ground looks like snow. Feels like home, stay in bed the whole weekend, it's nice to have a friend. Yeah, because like, the whole time she's saying it's nice to have a friend, but it's very obvious that this is more than friendship.
Yeah.
And I don't know, there's something really endearing about the song.
I personally would feel offended if "It's Nice to Have a Friend" was played on tour, but "So It Goes" wasn't.
Same, I love
that. That's just how
so
I
much.
Feel.
Oh, especially if another song is skipped and it's
well,
nice
that
to
too.
A friend. It's
yeah,
not.
That too.
Every other song apart from "Soon You'll Get Better" and "It's Nice to Have a Friend" needs to be on the tour.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we're moving on to the last song on the album, closer. We have lots to say about this.
We
so
do have lots
let's
to say
just
about
get
this.
In. It's called Daylight. My love was as cruel as the cities I lived in. So already we're just going into this absolute perfect album closer. She's reflecting on "my love was as cruel as the cities I lived in." She's saying her past and just like things that she's been through, and now how she's gotten to a place where now it's daylight, finally.
And I feel like that's the energy of the entire song. Like, she reflects on all the shitty relationships, how she's behaved, how others have behaved, but I don't feel that anymore. I only see daylight.
Yeah. Maybe you ran with the wolves and refused to settle down. Maybe I've stormed out of every single room in this town. Threw out our boots and our daggers because it's morning now. It's brighter now. Oh, that.
It's so good.
Whole pre-chorus.
Yeah.
Is building up to this obviously amazing burst of light in the chorus, but also I love just "we threw out all our cloaks and our daggers because it's morning now" is such a reference to Rep, because first of all, she was wearing cloaks the whole time she was in Rep, like the hoods and just the darkness, and just Rep was night, and it was fucking important to go through that, but it's daylight now, and we finally got that closure.
Yeah. And I can still see it all in my
obviously we have to reference just where she says, I once believed love would be burning red, and it's now daylight. So she's referencing back to Red, which is an album, three albums ago, and it's just...
Oh, well, yes, but also the song Red.
And also the song Red,
like,
yeah.
The actual lyrics burning red are in the song Red,
That part of her life, she literally thought love was red, it was burning red, like, it was passionate, it was intensity, and that's what she thought love was, and now she's found this whole different other love, which is golden, it's light, it's fucking diverse, and it's not black and white, and it's so many things.
I don't want to look at anything else now that I saw you. I can never look away. I don't want to think of anything else now that I thought of you. Things will never be the same. Been sleeping so long in a 20-year dark night.
You think that following in the middle of the night, I love.
I mean, I just think that that is just a superior way to close an album. Like, she has a very good ability to always open and close her albums perfectly.
Oh.
And like, it's just like, this song couldn't be placed anywhere else on the album. It needed to be at the end.
Oh, 100%. I mean, obviously, all of her album closes are superior, but... And I know that Clean is your absolute favourite, but I feel like this song really does hit different in the way that she's been through more.
Oh, absolutely.
To have been able to got to this place.
This song, Daylight, is just, it's obviously referencing her relationship with Joe, but I think she also has elements of referencing all the shit that she's been through she is.
Yes.
And so that's why it evokes more like she's been
more
through
emotion.
More. Mm-hmm. Clean is very specific
about
to a specific relationship.
Yeah, and you know, this song made such an impact on us that we actually got the last lyric that she says, "You are what you love," tattooed. I got it on my rib cage just here, and Em got it on her leg. I don't know, we just all connect to this album and this song and Taylor Swift in general. Like, this album means so much to us, but also because she's gone through so much, that lyric in particular just reminds me of like just staying positive, like how she's always managed to do that and how she's always managed to overcome everything and focus on the fact that she is what she loves, which is her music, which is her fans, which is like what she does,
and just not letting the rest of that shit that people, I mean, especially for her, the things that people say about her define her. She's not that. That's them and their opinion of her, but that's not her. She is who she is and who she loves.
Yeah.
I think that it's something that everyone can take away, a message that everyone can take away and relate to. Like, you are who you are.
Yeah.
What you want, what you love, what you... Like, you
and,
are you.
Yes.
You know, you're not what others think of you.
I also love that, because there's a quote that's, you are what you love, not who loves you. Which is kind of, I think, tying into that exact thing that she's trying to say as well. Everything, oh my God, this has just been so overwhelming to even try to begin to explain the process of our love for this album.
There's so many more things to say about every song. Like, I mean, this album.
Okay, so yeah, what's your top five? In order.
So, Death by a Thousand Cuts is my number one. I've got London Boy, Cruel Summer. I can only give you a top three because there's so many others that go into potential fours and fives. Like, we've got Cornelia Street, we've got Afterglow, we've got Daylight.
For me, it would be around a similar thing, I would say. Like, Death by a Thousand Cuts and Cruel Summer, definitely my top two. And then from then, it's a little bit hard for me to actually give an exact list. But I love I Think He Knows, I love Lover, I love London Boy, I love Afterglow, and I love Daylight. So they would be, like, the standouts for me. But I think, honestly, I feel like this album doesn't have a skip, me personally.
No.
Apart from maybe oh, I
so
always
get better.
Yeah, but that's for different reasons.
Yeah,
not
different
it's a song
reasons.
I don't
no.
like. It's just too
no.
sad to listen to.
Exactly.
And then maybe it's nice to have a friend. But I just think she nailed this album, and I know that it's not my number one favorite album of Taylor Swift. We'll get to that. But it's a fucking good album.
And it's just amazing how on her seventh album she can keep doing it so well.
It's
like,
incredible.
It's just so
it's
hard
no one
for
else
an artist
even
to do.
Touches it. If you don't know yet, you will learn to know how absolutely beyond superior Taylor Swift is, because this is her seventh album.
Yeah.
Can you imagine how good this album is, and you have like
have six others.
There's six others where she's already done superior.
And this isn't even our favourite.
No.
Like, but it's already So good.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah.
I think it's...
Oh, my God.
I think it might be my second or third favorite album.
Yeah, it's definitely up there.
It's definitely up there, yeah.
But it's not number one for either of us.
Yeah, yeah. I hope that you guys enjoyed this breakdown. Let us know what you would like us to continue to do in terms of... Because obviously this is our first video. We have no fucking idea what we're doing. We've never reacted to shit in our lives.
No.
So please give us your feedback. Yeah. Tell us what you want us to do in the coming albums. Yeah. Tell us and how you want us to break things down. What
we're even just like we're pretty open with doing everything. Like, this is obviously going to be a very long video.
Yeah.
But we're like, we can do
anything
you want, like, I don't care if it's a minute long.
No,
if I'm reacting to something that's like just a fucking one sentence, cool, I'll do it.
And also, we haven't decided what we want to call this channel yet. I think, like, we're just going to put it and we're just going to make it. But if you guys have anything that sparks your creativity, let us know for like names and just like what videos you want to see and all of that kind of stuff. And hopefully this wasn't too chaotic for you to watch, but we'll learn as we go.
Yeah, that's true.
Wow. Go and listen to Lover if you haven't already, and you know, follow along the storyline, see if any of the meanings that we talked about relate to you.
Oh, please, no, I want opinions.
Subscribe. Obviously, give this video a thumbs up.
Yes.
And we'll see you guys next time.
Yes, absolutely. You will.
Bye.
Bye.